quick story on that was, when I was this 10, 11 year old, I got on the phone and called the local PBS program director. Like, I'm a 10-year-old, right? And I said, his name was Jim Scott, and I bugged the daylights out of this poor man and said, can you run that special, because I'd really like to see it. I mean, like, tell you what you should put on the air. And he did. He got the special and ran it, and he said, okay, it's been 6 months, but I finally got the special, we're going to run it for you.
That's cool.
It was amazing.
Hi, how are you?
Hey.
You, that'll pull down.
Look at that. Yeah.
Make a guess.
Hi. I was actually really curious about what it was like to be working with PBS and all those different people, like, yeah, Fred Rogers, you had, what's his, it's Bill Nye, even at other times of the day. There were just so many brilliant people. It was Bob Ross. I just wondered what it was like interacting with all those.
Well, I have to be honest with you. I did meet Fred Rogers at one point, but we were in one place and they were shooting in another place, and we didn't cross paths a lot. Now, that's me, because when I was working at Sesame Street, it was a matter of what we would usually do with all the Ernie and Bert pieces that I was shooting. Kermit wasn't there, but it was mostly Ernie. Is that I would go up for a week or two to New York, and we would shoot a whole ton of those pieces, like day after day after day. We'd do, you know, 5 a day. And they would, that's what they call banking them. They would have them all back there. And then when they did the rest of the show, they would put those pieces into the shows. So once in a while, you know, someone would wander in and I'd get to meet them. And I didn't meet Mr. Rogers once, which is pretty neat.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello. Hi.
Hello. Oh, that's great.
That's
great.
Hi.
You got all the rows of teeth.
I want to make sure I have your nerves. But obviously, I love Dr. Crystal.
Yeah.
Just in terms of the storytelling, the mythos, the fact that they were going to be actors.
Right.
The elaborate experience, and also specifically to my understanding,
along with a whole bunch of people I was dragging along behind me, but yes.
So yeah, I wonder if you could elaborate on that final scene where he was attacked by all the prisoners.
Oh, great. Falls down the pit. Yeah, the best story about that is, well, okay, first of all, if you don't know, those Skeksis, this is the part you don't know, is that they were like wearing a torture device. They were these tight metal harnesses that placed the weight on your hip bones, which sounds better than being on shoulders, but it really wasn't. It was incredibly painful. You know, we were all dying. So I'm in there with one arm like this, in the head, of course, and the other arm is running a mechanical, big, scaling hand. Then there would be another puppeteer, could be any number of people, on the other side, running the other hand. And then at that point, it was really, we were getting the electrical, remote-controlled animatronics were very new. So we didn't have a lot of that going on. It was mostly done with these bicycle cables. And you'd squeeze this thing underneath the puppet and the eye would blink or the face would pulse, right? So in order to make all that work at one time, you had like 8 people you were dragging around behind you, running cables, you know, and like scurrying along the floor. So that was a little bit tough. But when we went to, the interesting thing about that movie was that I was able to do the voice of that character, which was hard. It was basically, you know who Peter Lorre is, the actor Peter Lorre? That's what I was going for, was like, you know, Peter Lorre. Which that's not really Peter Lorre, but that was my Peter Lorre. And Jim said, could you do a voice record? We're just getting everybody to do it. He didn't think I would be doing it. And so I played this character. Jim and Frank, because they co-directed that film, they came to me the next week and said, where did that voice come from? And I said, oh, I thought it was like really bad. I said, oh, I know, it was just something I was trying. He said, that's exactly what we want the Skeksis to sound like. So I got to do the voice. So when, you may not know this either, when the Dark Crystal was done in a language of its own. I don't remember what it's called, some of you may know. But the Skeksis spoke their own language, which was based on an actual language that made sense. I mean, you had to say it right. So we dubbed this whole thing after the fact. In that language, they did the tests of the film in front of audiences, and no one could figure out what the film was about because they were speaking this real language. It made no sense. So they said, okay, we're going to redub the film, We're going to do it half in the Skeksis language, which probably has a name, and half in English. They tested it again, and the audience had no clue what the film was about. They said, okay, now we're going to do it in English, and we'll do the whole thing in English. Well, that voice is pretty taxing, but for some reason, I think this was Jim's mischievous early side, he decided to have me do that scream falling down the pit every time we dubbed it. And he would say, we're just going to save that, do everything else first, and then we'll let you scream. I would do it like 5 times, you know, and the next day I couldn't talk. The top of my lungs.
Thank you so much.
Would you say you use that similar voice for Fraggle Rock?
Yeah, Marlon. Marlon Fraggle. The creepiest little weird puppet ever. he had like one eye that was bigger than the other, and I thought, oh, yeah, I still need to scream it. Yeah, I love that voice. It's just such a weird voice, you know. And by the way, that's not really what Peter Lorre sounds like, but if you look him up once in a while, you'll find something where he gets pretty close to that. He gets iron. Thank
you. So, of all the voices you've done, Bob, I'm trying to say this, you've done very good voices of Kermit and Ernie.
Thank you.
That Jim Henson's done before.
Yeah.
What is the one voice that you try to imitate, but you just can't do it? Because it's too hard, or it's a voice hard.
Well, I'll tell you the one that I had the most trouble with, by the way, I'm horrible with impressions of people. Not Peter Lorre, that's good. But trying, like, if you ask me to do an impression of this, I'm really bad at that. I'm not one of those people, it's like drawing caricatures. You know, some people find the essence of a person and they can exaggerate it. I'm not really good at picking that out in people's voices, which is why you get lucky. But the hardest character I ever had to try to do, this is ridiculous. You guys remember a character named Mr. Kitty Pants? Well, he wasn't one of my big known characters. But there's a guy named Kirk Thatcher, who's one of our longtime collaborators and directors. Terrific guy, a zany person. And this was something Kirk used to do, was this character, and it was Ed Wynn. You know, Ed Wynn, like, I had such a hard time getting even close. I just wanted Kirk to do it. He's not an experienced puppeteer, but I just said, we got to teach him puppeteer, but I can't do it. That was the hardest thing I ever tried to do, was get into that character.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
And look what we have here.
I know, we met yesterday. That is a beautiful puppet.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And what is your name?
Stephanie.
Yeah, I met Stephanie yesterday.
You say, like me, you loved Muppets since you were little, basically.
Yeah.
And what was it like telling your family all these years you're going into Muppets, and they think you're out of your mind, I'm sure they do.
A bit, yeah.
And then you find them to tell them, I got a job.
Okay.
What did they give you?
Well, the interesting part of that is I got the job while I was 18, so I was still living home with my parents, right? And I was barely out of high school. And my parents were very supportive about this in a cautious way. Because I'm living in this little, you know, urban, sort of almost rural town in Georgia, and what are the odds that I would ever work for the Muppets, you know? It's just not that likely it's going to happen, right? And I could be the biggest fan in the world. I remember my dad having this conversation with me once where he said, very gently, he just said, you know, what if this puppet thing doesn't work out? I mean, you know, oh, but Dad, no, okay. So, anyway, it, unfortunately it did. But I think they were very supportive, but in a cautious way. Yes. Yeah,
excellent. Thank you so much.
Rightly so, you know.
Hello, how are you?
I was wondering, Steve, I think that's okay. Out of all the characters that you played, which one is your favorite?
Well, the most fun that I've had with any character I've done was Rizzo the Rat.
Rizzo?
Yeah. Well, I did too, and I mean, he was a character that I originated, which was great fun, and he grew so much over the years, and for the first 4 or 5 years that I was doing Rizzo, again, I was very young, and I lived in Georgia, and suddenly I'm around all these talented performers, and I, I have no idea how to do a New York accent. It wasn't within me to do it. And then I'm there with Richard and Jerry, who are these two brilliant performers. And they're doing Rats around Rizzo. Rizzo's supposed to be the leader of the Rats. And I've got these two incredibly strong performers, and I'm this shy person trying to hold my own. It's really hard. But I probably learned a lot from the two of them about, you know, how you talk to the New York thing, you know? And then Rizzo became like an outlet, you know? I do Kermit most of the time, and Kermit's nice and pure, and he has his moments where he gets frustrated, but he's basically this good-hearted, graceful person we all know, right? And Rizzo can be kind of a jerk sometimes, you know? You know, on the days you get up and you're in not in the best mood. I think Carol might relate this to Big Bird and Oscar. They're like opposite ends of your emotional spectrum, you know? It's the same kind of thing. So Rizzo's probably my favorite.
Rizzo and
yeah,
it's a combination. It blows my mind the fact that it's, to me, it's the funniest combination of two Muppets, yet the simplest little tiniest mouth flapping.
I feel like that's part of why they work, because they're these two little annoying little guys who feel this sense of entitlement to everything, you know? And they're just pushed their way in. Done by Bill Moretta, who's a Philly native, by the way.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
How are you?
Hi, I'm doing great today. My name is Philly.
Hey, Logan. Again? We know each other.
Yes. So, what is your personal favorite Sesame Street or the Muppets song?
Oh, wow. Well, it sounds like a cliche for me to say this, but the first time I heard It's Not Easy Being Green was on Sesame Street with Jim performing, and certainly loved it. Robert Duffy was always great. Yeah, I look forward to seeing that one. And of course, Mama Mama was fantastic. But do any of you remember back in the early days of Sesame, I don't know how they got away with this, I guess just different times. Jim did these sketches to like Beatles songs, like Yellow Submarine, Octopus's Garden. He couldn't do that, man. He couldn't afford it. And I'm sure they just stole it. Yeah. It didn't matter then. But those things are pretty great too.
That's great. How many times in your career have you sang
Grandpa Benjamin?
Yeah.
And I get asked that sometimes, and I don't know. But it's
more of a rhetorical, probably saying it a lot of
times. A lot. It comes with the territory of the Kermit. People want to hear that. By the way, I'm not going to sing it now, so just
don't. No,
but I start to cry. I can't do that. It's such a beautiful song, and as you probably all know, Paul Williams wrote this, and Paul is a dear friend to all of us who work with the Muppets. He's worked with us on many, many things for many, many years, so I'm always proud to be able to do it.
All right, guys, we're running pretty short on time here, so we'll get a couple more.
Thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you. How are you?
Hey, how are you? How are you again?
Hey!
These are all my pals.
I'm like working with Frank Oz, the guy who did Bert, Ricky Martin, Ricky Lobo, Animal.
Yeah.
Yoda, Mickey, Dan Eagle, God bless you.
Awesome.
What was it like working with all the legendary who I look up to? What was it like to knowing that you were working with these wonderful people? God bless.
Yeah, it was the best thing that could have ever happened to a Muppet fan.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's really interesting. It's something I figured out because I had the opportunity to be a really big fan, and then I had certain preconceived notions about the Muppets. I had my own thoughts about them and my own interpretations. But to have the opportunity then to move into an area where I was working along with people like Jim and Frank, you know, and a lot of my preconceived notions were flat wrong. And it was great to see, to have those things turned into a more accurate perspective of who the Muppets are. Jim had a lot of great methods in the way that he did things, and very important to the Muppet success.
Amazing.
Yeah. Hey, thank you.
Guys, I'm very, very sorry, but we have to cut it short right there. We've got another panel coming in. We've got to get Steve.
Sure,
if you guys want to go over to Steve's table, I'm sure you're happy to answer all these type questions there. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming.
Thanks, guys.